So why are you here?
I'm here hopefully to talk about big plans for certain tournaments moving forward and recap a little bit of CEO with you and see how it was from your perspective, from the attendee point of view, and then I can give the stream sort of the stream monster perspective on the other side.
Okay. So why weren't you able to make it to CEO?
I had some real life conflicts that were in place pretty far ahead in advance. My little brother was out at UMD College Park for a concert symphony music festival, and the final concert was Saturday. So I knew like months in advance that I was going to have to be here because my entire family came out. So unfortunately, real life got in the way, but Miss CEO, but I will be at Evo, I will be at SmashCon, I will be at Shine, I will be at Big House, and then I am still in the works for Genesis. So we'll see.
Nice. You're from the Midwest, right?
Yeah. I don't know if you have, I guess the cam isn't on me, but I'm wearing my Big House shirt.
Nice. Are you going to be doing the commentator organization again?
I will. So I'm going underway for SmashCon. We're still getting responses there, and then I'll be doing Big House, and so those two are on my. Oh, you guys can see me. Cool. So those two are on my agenda in terms of manager stuff, and then like I said, Shine and Genesis. Hopefully, I'll just be there as a competitor, as a commentator, and as a fan of the game. So we'll see.
So have you like now become the commentator organization guy? Is that like, can we default and assume that whenever you're at a national that you will be the guy that determines the commentators?
I don't know. I guess so. Juggle Guy and I are very close friends, and it sort of went through a progression both of trusting me in my commentary skills and then my commentary management skills. So I started like everyone, just like at the very bottom doing beginning of bracket pools, and then worked my way up to doing pretty much all of Juggle Guy's in-state tourneys. And then he trusted me to do a little bit of work for his bigger tourneys. And then he asked me if I wanted to be the commentary manager for Big House 5. And I had a general idea of what I was doing, but not a perfect idea. And then we worked it out really well, and it was amazing. And then he just sort of spread the good word. And then Nintendude, another good friend of mine, said that, hey, you know, I got really great sort of referrals from Juggle Guy, from the VG Bootcamp team, that the work that you did at Big House was exemplary, so we'd love to have you on board. And then Pound went really well. And then Wife, he got his attention too. And he even said the same thing you did. He was like, I guess you're the guy now, so if you want to do SmashCon, that would be great. And I was like, absolutely. So those three, as for now, and then we'll see moving forward. I know Shine has an independent, I think Big Blue Esports is doing that, and then Genesis has their sort of Genesis crew. Ashcon did a great job with Genesis 3, and I'm sure if they bring them back, it'll be just as good for Genesis 4.
So are you and Ashcon rivals then in this limited space of commentator?
I wouldn't call us rivals per se, because we're both really like, and this is going to sound, you know, like, I guess for lack of a better term, fake, but I honestly am just in it to give tournaments the best possible commentary that I can give. It's not necessarily for me or for the tournament organizers, but obviously when you have 50,000, 70,000, 100,000 people tuning in, it has to be good commentary, right? So I do my best from networking to find what commentators are coming to try and sweeten the deal for them, and just work what I'm given with. And I always make sure my like core principle is to maintain a running dialogue with the tournament organizer. So I'm always messaging Juggle Guy. I'm always messaging Nintendude, Wife now, just be like brainstorming what we could possibly do to make the tournament as enjoyable as possible. Because obviously people there aren't going to be able to really enjoy it, because we haven't totally embraced the idea of FGC commentary, which I love, and I would love to see that implemented more. But for now, it's still just all about the sort of at-home viewer.
What do you mean FGC commentary?
When they play, I love hearing commentary over the mic. I think it adds, like when you're in the venue, I think it adds so much more to the experience, especially if you have a situation where you have players that aren't quite as knowledgeable. Like, for example, I was a combo breaker, and they had giant in-house venue speakers for Street Fighter, and Tasty Stevens Sajam were amazing. And it made it that much better for me in person, because if they didn't have in-house commentary, I would just be sitting there like, I have no idea what is going on. Mm. So I think it lends a lot to both at-home viewers and in-person viewers then, if you start incorporating that. And Combo Breaker tried to do it. We got one game off, Duck versus Dreffen, and Duck immediately looks at, I think it was Apostle who was like running the camera, and Gamer, and he goes, can we cut that off? And that was it. No mas. But I would love to see that implemented more in the future, but we'll see.
Oh my gosh, that Duck. I heard like he's actually like a really mean person.
He's a bit of a quack.
So if you don't like somebody or they're like a douchebag to you, but they're kind of like an up-and-comer commentator, do you just give them random pulls or doubles pulls?
No, not necessarily. Well, first and foremost, I honestly think that I don't have beef with any commentators. I try not to have beef in general, but it just happens sometimes. But with commentary especially, and this sort of stems with real-world experience, is that you can't let personal either convictions or feelings get in the way of doing your job professionally to the best of your ability. So hypothetically, let's just say I hated Scar, which I don't. I love Scar. If I hated him, but he was coming to the tournament that I'm organizing, I know it's still best for the tournament to give him the slots that he deserves. So like, we all have to put in our time. So when I have like, especially for Big House, when even with three streams, we had pretty much every big name for commentary in attendance. So I had to give a couple like S-tier casters, basically. Like Webs and Vish did top 64. And what other tournament are you going to see commentators of that caliber sort of be relegated to? Not necessarily, it's not a bad slot, but it's definitely a slot that if you have like a major or a regional, then those guys are doing top 8, no questions. So it's tough, and someone has to make the tough calls. But people understand that it's a business, right? We're trying to run the best tournament we can, and sometimes we have to make tough decisions. And I've had to do that. I've had to explain to people that are used to doing top 8s, that are used to doing top 32s, that, hey, you know what? I'm really sorry, but we're going to go this other direction. It's just kind of a decision that has to be made.
Fair enough. Smash in Espanol, of course, is going to ask, like, is there going to be more direction towards bilingual commentary, since you have probably more insider information than most people?
Yeah, I hope so. Pound was probably the first real major to do a Spanish simulcast, and it was awesome from what I like. All the feedback was super positive. Nan and DJ apparently killed it. And I think that opens up an entirely new contingency of viewers that we didn't really have access to that might have felt alienated. So I would love to do that more often. And I think it'll be something that I'll try and implement for Smashdown, almost definitely for Big House. I would be surprised if we didn't have one for Big House, just based on how well it went for Pound. But then that's like the issue is that we have obviously a very short pool of casters that can do that. It would pretty much have to be Nunn or DJ, or like DJ recommended Ben Teasy, but he didn't go to Pound. But he's someone else that he could have just discussed the game with, could have had fun on the mic with. So I would love to. And I think that's a route that we can continue to take. But the more casters that may be bilingual that want to get into it, the better. Just because, you know, while all English casters sort of have this route that they have to take slowly to get up to the big pools, the big brackets, you know, the competition is not nearly as fierce, right? So if you speak Spanish and you want to get into commentary, I highly recommend that you do it, because there's going to be hopefully a huge market soon. But we'll have to see. We'll have to get some more people. But like I said, Nunn and DJ were apparently great.
Yeah, I'm more looking forward to it too, because I think that's one of our, I guess, low-hanging fruits to continue our growth. Mm-hmm. Speaking of like kind of different commentary kind of models, are you doing trilingual commentary again at Super Smash Con, or
I don't know. I haven't talked to wife about it yet. That would be, that'd be fun to get either Toph or, because Amsa's going to be there, but I don't know how willing Amsa would be to commentate. But that would be amazing to have a Japanese stream as well. But that's something that I guess I still have to talk to wife about. We haven't even, we haven't discussed anything sort of logistically because he hasn't given me a schedule. So there's, I'm just kind of chilling on that, waiting for exactly, because I start doing my best work when I know what I can work with, right? I know how many blocks we have. I know how many streams we're going to have. I know what events we're going to cast. And until I get that, then it's just kind of gathering talent, seeing who's coming, seeing who's interested. But we'll see.
I'm excited.
Me too, man. It's going to be fun.
I was, man, what was it? I had a blast at CEO. Although I think it was a little bit difficult for me towards the end, for a commentary.
Yeah, you guys were on really late. 1:30 ending.
Yeah, because, it's kind of one of those things where you're kind of trying to energize yourself up since, or I guess I was trying to energize myself up since like 7:30.
Yeah.
And I was just like, okay, let's do it. And then I heard it's like going to be 9 o'clock. And then I was like, okay, like I'll keep my energy going. Like since I've been up since like 8 a.m. Mm-hmm. And then they're like, no, it's actually at 10 o'clock. And so we kept, you know, delaying it. And I was just like, oh my gosh, I'm like running out of energy already.
Yeah. And I heard you also had, you had something go on with, you were supposed to do some top 16 or top 32 warm-up stuff, right?
Yeah.
Like what happened there?
So what happened there was, there's a lot of commentary reshuffling, and I'm sure, I forgot who it was, but I know an up in somebody from Panda Global was a little bit disappointed that all his commentator blocks got taken away from him.
Yeah.
And
what, Smash 4, I think Dom?
Yeah, Dom.
Yeah.
And what ended up happening on day one was they're supposed to have three streams in total, but that didn't happen, so there were only two. And not only did the streamers switch, but like the commentators were like juggled, and it was kind of a communication mess. So, for example, I woke up at 8:30 to get to my block, and it turned out I didn't need to be there, and so I was a little bit upset. And then on day two, there was a lot of reshuffling, and Gimmer ended up having to move on to do Street Fighter, and then MVG ended up replacing them on Melee and Smash 4. So there's a lot of shuffling and a lot of miscommunication going on, which is unfortunate.
Do you know, if I may ask, who was in charge of commentary for CEO?
I honestly don't know. I mean, we have this sheet called like the CEO Bible that was private that gave us all the schedules, not just for commentary, but for like all the logistics.
Mm-hmm.
And then on Friday morning, they had two tabs, one with an old commentator sheet and one called new commentator sheet. But this wasn't really communicated to anyone until like you go to the station and you realize, hey, like you're not commentating anymore.
That's it. Like they gave you no heads up until you got to the station. Oh my God.
Absolutely none.
Oh my God.
And so it was kind of tough to deal with. And so that's why the Dom issue happened. And it was just overall just kind of confusing, especially when the two streams on Saturday switched. Like Polarity and MVG, the MVG streams were switching back and forth repeatedly.
Mm-hmm.
So it was kind of it was a little bit of a mess.
Yeah. So even given the circumstances, I thought you and Toph did a really good job. I thought it was probably some of the best, and this is obviously to no surprise, some of the best analytical commentary that I have I've heard in a long time. I think you sort of put yourself up there with the wobbles. I think it's the two of you sort of in a class of your own in terms of just pure understanding. I guess PPMD, but he's not really around as much anymore. But I thought you and Toph were great. I learned a lot, and I really understood a lot more about certain, specifically with not necessarily always micro spacings, but just the tiny micro interactions that I would normally miss because I'm a buffoon and I just love to shout and get hype. I thought you guys were great, especially for the circumstances. I have to give you mad props. So I just want to say that for sure.
I really appreciate it because I was getting a little like anxious before because top 8 always has a lot of expectations, and Scar actually pep talked me before, which actually helped my mindset going into it a lot.
He's the best, man. He's great.
I'm going to actually move areas because for some reason this plug doesn't work for my battery. That's at 7%.
Oh, shit. Okay. So, I'm going to run 10 seconds. Actually, not even 10 seconds. I'm just going to...
But, yeah, I mean, I know, I mean, I think the big thing I get out of it, it's everybody was really encouraging, so I'm really thankful for that. Why isn't my, okay, now we're charged again.
Cool.
Yeah,
I just, you know, it, so someone asked me recently, you know, how often, when are we going to be ready as a community for top eights that aren't Scar and Toe, Fit R and D1 and Blur, Homemade Waffles and Phil, right? Those are, I tend to think those three pairings are sort of the golden standard. There's a lot of obviously other pairings that are really great. Homemade Waffles that's coming up. They've done a lot of great work recently. And then you can sort of mix and match. I think Scar and Waffles are a great combo. And I think that it's finally time for some majors to start taking initiatives and start giving these spots to other talented casters that really deserve it, that have been putting in a lot of work. And just because Scar, obviously Scar and Topher are not going to be with us forever, right? Scar's already sort of like phasing his way out.
Yeah.
At least it seems like that, right? So I think, see, I applaud CEO going in the direction of you, and I think that I am sort of inspired by that. For SmashCon, at least, I know for Big House it's going to be tough just because Scar and Topher have done top eight for the last three, and it's kind of like where they got their like whole Scar and Tove original, like, this is the duo from. But it's just something that we have to think about as a community.
Yeah, definitely, because, you know, Scar can come because he had to unleash, you know, what was announced today, the bits and the cheers.
Yeah.
And so that's what's been taking his time, especially in the past 2 months. And, you know, and like I've mentioned earlier, everybody was really supportive of me, and I think at the end, you know, what I take away from this is, like, I'm very critical of myself, so I know that I do have many aspects of my commentary that I can improve on, and I am going to be trying to do things to continue to improve that. And I see that a lot from you too, like, where, like, every time you commentate or Webs commentate, you guys are stepping up and getting more opportunities because you guys are improving so much every time. And so I think one of the things I'm going to be implementing for myself is I actually have a voice coach. That's
awesome.
A personal friend of mine. And so what I'm going to continue to do is just see how I can develop more of a rhythm and flow. I think that even Wobbles, even though he's a little bit more analytical, has a pretty solid flow. And so that's going to be one thing I'm going to be working on in the next month. And also, I think some people criticize Toph, but I think partly it's the synergy aspects.
Mm-hmm.
And I felt that I could have done a better job alley-ooping and setting up Toph, because I felt like I was playing the solo Fox main that wanted, like, all the analytical stuff, and, like, I gave Toph nothing to work with. So for people who are complaining, saying, like, he was just saying, yeah, sure, it's because, like, I took all the meat and I just gave him bones and scraps to work with.
It's interesting. I only think there are a few commentators that are exceptionally good at that. I stink at it. I'm sort of the same way, where I'll either wait for a cue or sort of like find my spot, get in and get out. But I think the person to study for that is Homemade Waffles. I think Brandon is on another level when it comes to just engaging his co-commentator in a conversation. And that's why when you ask anyone that's ever commentated with him, it's like, oh, he's so easy to work with. You can ask Ipengu, who's like, oh, easily Homemade Waffles was like the easiest person to work with, because that's what he does. He just sets you up so nicely for you to just spike it down. And that's something we can all work on. And that also just comes from time, like you said, synergy, from practice working with each other. Because when was the last time you and Toph commentated together?
I mean, we did like an hour block, but honestly, I think it was Kings of Cali 1. We did like 30 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And that's pretty much it. It was like 4 years ago. I think Homemade Waffles, what I like about him, he's like evolved so much as a commentator. And I think he's found himself that, like, because, like, when you're starting to get in, you want to prove yourself as much as possible. And sometimes you word vomit. But I think Brandon understands his role in commentary. And he's like grown so much as a person that I don't think that insecurity is there for him to say, like, I need to do everything. He knows that he can step back and play this like role that actually, at the end of the day, is better for everybody. But yeah. I'm going to, before you go on, I have to get the rest of my stuff. I'm actually hogging two rooms, so I'll be right back.
Okay. All right. We got a lot of homies in the chat while they're stepping away. I see Alex and Destiny fan, Nodii, Tiff. Sup, peeps? Thanks for tuning in. This has been, it's been a little fun.
Alrighty, I'm back. What's up, Fendi? What are you looking at?
I was just saying hello to the stream. Just saying what's up to chat. But so what's your next venture? Let's talk about what you got coming up and how seriously. Obviously, you plan on taking commentary pretty seriously. But what do you have lined up for the couple months, the next few months? I'm excited.
So I'm doing Evo, SmashCon, and Shine.
Okay. Nice.
And so we'll
be at all the same tournament.
Yeah, it's gonna be sick. I think that I already have all my writing gigs, so just like maintaining my presence on ESPN, Yahoo, and Red Bull.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to get out about two articles a week on average. I'm gonna be working on a Road to Evo series for ESPN, where I'm gonna be interviewing different players to see what their goals are, like what they're gonna be doing.
Mm-hmm.
And then also. Tafo stats, so I'm being contracted by SmashCon and Shine to bring stats, so...
Ooh, baby.
What's up?
I said, ooh, baby, let me some Tafo.
Yeah, and so I'm just refining the code to make it a lot more efficient on my end, so Smash GG integration's in there now, and I modified the code a little bit so that I can scrape Smash 4 data instantaneously, so I'm going to try to work on some Smash 4 stuff. So I'm really excited to see how it pans out. And then after Evo, I'm going to be working on metadata from the tournament, where I'm going to look at counter picks, stage picks, and see like what different factors influence like whether or not a person wins. I'm going to look at clutch factor, like who does the best at game fives, who wins when like it's a one stock game. And look at stuff like that to see if I could find anything interesting.
Nice. I think, yeah, it's a great time to get into Smash 4. Honestly, I think we're both pretty Melee-centric guys, but I think Smash 4 at CEO was next. It was super fun to watch. I thought it was an amazing tournament, and I'm glad that the sort of community, like, basically the closest thing that they have to a Leffen, and I feel like maybe Allies that too, but seeing Anti win was... That was awesome. That was super fun.
Yeah, it's
even though I'm a Michigan guy and I was rooting really hard for Zenodo, it was still cool.
I think they're in a really good spot for their meta, and I like that their personalities are starting to come out. I think Anti, for example, has like a really interesting personality and he has a lot of charisma in an Anti sort of way. And yeah, I think Smash 4, like, for a while, like, I thought it was, like, a little bit stale, but CEO, like, showed me that it's actually, like, really exciting right now.
Yeah. And it sucks to root against someone, but I think Zero, the string of tournaments that Zero's not winning is given that the boost that it really needed.
Yeah.
And especially him not even being in top 8, that is crazy. That's never happened before. Like, they said the last time he didn't get top 8 at any tournament he entered was... Evo 2014 Melee, where he got 17th. That's incredible longevity and consistency. It's amazing.
It's a crazy run. I think the worst thing that happened for them was Zero losing and then like winning like every tournament again to like, kind of break that streak.
Because
like the narrative was like, when will Zero lose? And it's like, oh my gosh, he got the game 3, but then he lost the streak. And then so it's exciting times. But what do you think of Melee overall?
So I put a lot of thought into this. I think the CEO, so in case it wasn't clear to the viewers, I and Tafo both are huge sports nuts. I saw a lot of the French Open in this tournament where you had at this point, you have Novak, number one seed going in. You have Hungry Box. And then you have Federer not even going. So that's Armada not going. And then you have Nadal dropping out halfway through the French. That's equivalent to Leffen, or excuse me, one of the two. I lost my analogy. But basically, you lost Armada, you lost Mango, you lost Leffen, you lost Federer, you lost Nadal. And so it wasn't as exciting, right?
Yeah.
We had this really deep conversation of a couple friends. If Hungry Box won CEO before Leffen and before Mango dropped out, where does that put him in contention with Armada for the best player alive? Where does that go leading into Evo? And now it was just sort of another notch in the belt for Hungry Box, right? He's been on a tear for 2016, but there really was no competition there. No offense to Mewtwo King, but there was nobody there who was conceivably was going to be Hungry Box twice. And that just speaks to the dominance that Hungry Box has over everybody other than like Leffen right now, and even Mango. And it was a bummer, right? It was a huge bummer to see Mango pull out. And I hate the personal reasons meme because I'm sure he had a damn good reason not to go, right?
Yeah.
You don't walk away from $6,000 and really big momentum boost going into the biggest tournament ever. So it sucks that we lost Mango and Leffen. And we still had some great sets. Pew Pew UH Box was a great, great set. We had some amazing top eight sets, most notably Plup and SFAT for one, and also Plup and who'd he come back against? 3-0? He was
Axe.
Axe. Yeah, Axe. He was getting destroyed by Axe and then brought it back. So those two sets were, in my mind, the sets of the tournament. And to be honest, I actually didn't even watch Grands. I was like, there's no point for this. I would love to see Mewtwo King start going Marth and talk to whether to talk to Pew Pew U, talk to Smash God even, start really labbing that matchup, because Marth could do it, right? And I think Mewtwo King can do it. And I saw you tweet out an answer where if he goes Fox, right, he'll just laser, but he'll give up too much space and get back aired.
Yeah.
And it's just not working. So we'll see. Oh, yeah. And Plup, Mewtwo King. Plup was just in a bunch of really good sets, man.
Yeah, Plup was I think the advantage of this top eight was there were three Sheiks, and I'm a Sheik main, so
yeah.
Like it was just my comfort zone where I'm like, oh, like this is what they're looking for. Oh, that's interesting. So I just love seeing like really good movement from Sheiks. So like I can kind of like take mental notes on how they're maneuvering against like fast characters like Pikachu.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a really exciting thing for me. The energy, you know, from being there was actually like really strange though, and I kind of alluded to it in commentary that you could kind of sense like negative energy from it. Quite a few people there.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end of the day, I'm really glad that like Mewtwo King found a way to come back against Plup. Plup found a way to come back against Axe. Because most of the other times when you kind of look at their demeanor, you kind of, in any other event, they would just kind of give up.
Mm-hmm.
And
you just get 2-0 Mollywop for the first two games.
Yeah, because like Plup looks so demoralized after he lost to Mewtwo King and after being up 2-1 in game 5.
Yeah.
After losing that, I just didn't think he was going to win another set for the rest of the day. So overall, like I made a comment on it. I mean, Armada still, you know, has the last laugh on Hungry Box, but I think Armada still takes it because, you know, we've given him, for Armada to surpass Mango, Armada had to win like so much and he had to pay his dues. And I think for Hungry Box, he kind of still has to do the same.
It was Big House 5, Genesis. That was like, Genesis was the sort of turning point, right? Would you agree? Like that was when we're like, all right. What else? He also won a bunch in the summer.
I mean, he won Evo too.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
I mean, Evo, Big House, and the fact that like Mango didn't even make it to grand finals, I think, kind of done it in.
Yeah, fifth place.
So, I think by Big House, it was pretty obvious that Armada, you know, took the crown by then.
So that segues into something I kind of want to talk about. If Hungry Box wins Evo, does he take the crown from Armada?
No question about it. I mean,
yeah.
That would, I mean, even if Hungry Box doesn't play Armada, or like, let's say in some weird circumstance, Hungry Box and Armada play out in winners, Armada wins, but like Armada gets outplayed somehow. I don't know how that would happen logistically.
Hey, HBox would have to lose in like quarters.
Yeah.
Yeah, which isn't happening.
I still think that because of Gommel, HBox has outplaced Armada at two tournaments in a row. Like, let's say if he won, that I don't really value that Smash Summit 2 as much. Given that HungryBox has now like won all these majors that Armada hasn't gone to. On top of that, HungryBox outplacing Armada at two events.
Yeah.
And so I would have to, I mean, I think with how prestigious Evo is and how everybody's going to be there, I think you have to give it to HungryBox.
Yeah, I agree.
So that's my thoughts on it. I think the interesting intangibles, though, is that we have, I mean, I think the top five right now, to be honest, is like fairly set in stone in some order. Like you have the big four plus Mutiking. Mm-hmm. It's going to be interesting to see how 6 through 15 kind of shuffle and pan out in the next 2 months.
I think 7. I honestly think Plup is pretty securely at 6. If you're removing PPMD from the equation, because we don't know if we're going to go to Evo.
I guess, yeah, we could put Plup in 6.
Yeah, but I think, yeah, then I agree. I think 7 to 15. I think, obviously, you have Axe and you have Wes, but I think SFAT has been playing out of his mind recently. So has Wizzy. You know, it's been fun to watch these guys put like really bring the heat. Like Wizrobe is what? He got 9th of Pound and then he got like 4th of PAX. He got top 8 at DreamHack. He's been on a freaking tear. And lucky until this tournament hadn't lost anyone outside the top 6 in months. Like it's been I think you're completely right that gap is small.
Yeah.
Shroom just been playing really well too. Who else is around there? We haven't seen anything from Silent Wolf, really, but he had a kind of a rough March and April getting trounced at Smash Summit, where he didn't take a game in any major competition. I think he got top 8 at Battle of the Five Gods, but he also squeaked by via tiebreaker in the first round of pools. So
he beat Fake PP.
Yeah. It wasn't like, wow, you know, Silent Wolf is definitely maintaining the number 11 rank that he has. But it'll be interesting. I Silent Wolf definitely going to Evo. Do we know if he's going to anything else?
I think he's keeping a light summer. I actually don't know what his... It's kind of interesting that he got signed by Team Secret and he's not like attending much either. And it's a summer, so I don't know if he has summer school or what exactly his personal life situation is. But it's kind of interesting that he gets signed, but he's not really attending much.
Yeah.
It's gonna, and then we also have to toss in Swedish Delight into the mix.
Yeah, he's been playing what? 4th of Pound, 2nd at Smash and Splash. You got 9th at CEO, which is still nothing to shake your head at. He's been on a tear as well. Who else has been playing really well?
I don't know if anyone's like really kind of stood out. I think everybody's come in kind of hot and cold. So this is kind of where you have like the upper end of 7 to 15, and then you have like 13 to 20, some overlap, where like they have some good performances, and then they get like a 17th, or like they get a 13th, or they like completely drown in like one or two brackets.
Yeah, that might be that. Mine is like, I think Cobol for that. But before CEO, he'd been playing really, really, really well. And then he just got out of nowhere, lost to
Kalamazoo
in losers. And then he lost to the Moon. Yeah, he lost to the Moon in winners and then lost to Kalamazoo in losers. And the Moon has beaten him like 3 times in a row. So that's not hugely surprising. That's just, I think, a bad draw. But as much as I love Kyle, losing to Keizu, that's rough. But yeah. He's been putting together a great 2016 since. So, and I think, who else? Like, maybe Pew Pew got sort of back on the right track, even though, like, that's a tough bracket when you have to play HBox and immediately drop down and have to play Axe. That's tough.
Yeah, but then again, like, his advancement to get that point wasn't the hardest either.
But yeah, he got, like, what? It was, like, Mike Hayes and then Nightmare.
Yeah, because I think he was targeted to play West Bowls. To be honest, I think like he would do well against West Bowls, but at the same time, like West Bowls wasn't there, and he had to play Nightmare because chilling might be out of winners.
He also might be out of losers. Did you hear how he lost to Mike Hayes?
He had the edge guard, and instead of like back airing, he fell off and died.
Peace. Yep.
Yeah, that's like I think I tied Chilling, dude. So that's like saying a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can't tie me if you're signed. Like, you should lose your sponsorship if you tie Tafo Kinson bracket. So yeah, I mean, it's like interesting. So like, I'm hoping that with school out for Kevin or PPU that he gets back into a grind. He lives literally blocks away from SFAT, so there's no excuse on practice at this point. Whereas when he was at school, he didn't have a car. Shroom's gone, so he doesn't really have much meaningful practice. Mm-hmm. But in the next 3 weeks until Evo, which is kind of crazy that Evo's in 3 weeks, by the way, that he should be able to get to practice and hopefully not run into Axe.
Yeah. Man, I like want to say he'll figure that out, but he just can't. Like, Axe just has his number, man.
I mean, but to be fair, like, I think PPU, despite it being 3-1, I think PPU, I mean, the matches were a lot closer than previous times, and it's clear to me that PPU was kind of working on the neutral game, and those matches were pretty close. It's not like it was like a two-stock every game, and Axe just kind of ran him over.
Yeah,
that's true. But that's the third tournament, by the way, that Axe has eliminated PPU in ninth.
Man. That's tough.
Yeah, so it's interesting. I mean, and then he almost beat Hungry Box. I mean,
like I said, that set was amazing, and I think Mutsu King has a lot to learn from PPU in terms of how he could go Marth. But
I think there's still a long way for Mutsu King to ever go Marth. Just I mean, you mentioned that you didn't really watch the set at that point, but he kept instinctively trying to grab Hungry Box as Marth and. It just looks really ugly.
I didn't have to see it, but I know exactly what you're talking about. You're just like, yes, I'm going to get this grab, and then you just whiff this crouching puff, and the ping, you're just dead.
Unfortunately, Hungry Box didn't start punishing it until game two, where Hungry Box, or he switched to Sheik. But yeah. It didn't look pretty, and like for the fact that the majority of the audience knew that he was playing it wrong, it tells you a lot.
Yeah, I think Evo will be interesting. Obviously, you touched on a little bit on Twitter, too. The whole best of three creates a little bit more variance, which will be fun.
So, it's interesting. I think Ice Climbers have their own kind of story to this, too, because we had three in the top 16. Nintendude, I think, got 13th. This kid made a run through S2J, Lucky. Yeah,
I want to talk before, I guess, sorry to cut you off, about Diz's run. That was amazing, right? He beats Prince Boo, and then he beats S2J, and then he beats Lucky.
He also beats Zoo.
Yeah. Those are four top 50 players, top 60, whatever, wherever you want to put Prince. But that's a hell of a run. And he had the same similar run of Fight Pit where he beat a bait. Hugs, none, duck in a row. Yeah. Right? I don't care what character you play. If you do runs like that, that's just impressive to me. To me, at least.
I agree.
Yeah, and so ninth place at CEO for Diz is exceptional. And he texted me early on Saturday after I told him that, or I like defended him by saying he's as nice as his playstyle is degenerate. And he goes, so you think I'm really mean? And I'm just like, all right, Kyle, just go out there, do your thing. And he's like, good. I'm feeling good. And then he just pulls off this impressive run after he lost to Nintendude and Ice Climbers Dittos, which is one of his favorite matchups, too. And then he just pulls off the sick run in Losers. And I was really happy for him. I think he's a great player. And it'll be interesting. Maybe, you know, what, 2013 was Wobbles, 2014 was Fly, 2015 was Chew. So it's going to come down to Nintendude or Diz. And I think if he gets the right bracket, I think either of them could do it. But Diz is definitely showing that he's not a slouch, man.
Yeah. It's going to be... And then you're going to have, the up-and-coming Ice Climbers too, like Infinite Numbers. And I'm pretty sure there's going to be players like Fork that are going to be there that are probably going to be making some pretty big runs. It's interesting, though, that you mentioned Disc Kid Boogie and SJ, because you know, SJ did beat him pretty decisively at an Arizona tournament, and then this kid did run it back, which is impressive. Unfortunately, you know, Wizzy, very well prepared by then.
Yep. And that's something that's, it's just the difference, like getting hit by down throw, down air in 2016, right? It's kind of funny. You know, SDI is so crucial, and Wizzy showed just how important it is, and he was able to win. And then it was so sad. I different ice climbers watching Shrooms Marth getting down throw, down air, re-grabbed as Marth. Like, he doesn't know that you can literally just like hold up and then you get out of that. And it's just something, it's the little things that can, because I think Diz has some of the better wobbling setups in the game. If you just know these setups, then you can get out of it. It's there's a reason why you see players like Cobol, Mango, Professor Pro, they just don't lose to ice climbers, because it's just they actually care enough to know the matchup. And I think the sooner people stop bitching about wobbling and actually learning how to beat ice climbers, then we'll start seeing a little bit more of a regression. Until then, until we keep seeing none whine about it on Twitter every tournament.
All the players you mentioned have one thing in common, though. They're very old. Well, except for maybe Professor Pro. They're all really old school players.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not sure if you follow Marvel 2 very much at all. Do you?
I do not, unfortunately. Okay.
So in Marvel 2, the new school players play like Magneto, Storm, Sentinel, Cable, right? And they know those matchups inside and out. It's like, I guess the equivalent would be like a new school player being highly technical and knowing like Fox, Marth, Falco, Sheik, those managers pretty well.
Okay.
But then, like, you see that player like Yipes lose to janky Spiral team, but like the old school players know how to play that matchup because they grew up in that meta.
Mm.
And it's really tough to, you know, to really understand those little setups unless you like play and have experience in it, because you can only theorycraft so much.
Yeah.
And then when you have ideas and you're like, aha, like I can counter you, this kid Boogie. Like, this kid Boogie can come out with a secondary game plan to counter your counter, and then what?
Yeah. It's true. Good point.
So it's one of those things where I know that Juggle Guy a long time ago said like he wanted to ban wobbling, but then you look at the long term of it, like look at how much it kind of hurts your local scene because they don't get the practice they need.
Yeah, we had a situation where as soon as Juggle Guy lifted the ban in Michigan, this guy, Quang, who is a pretty mid-level Fox player, switches to Ice Climbers and immediately just starts getting a bunch of random PR wins. And now he's number 8 on the PR because Michigan is still that much further behind against Ice Climbers. And now it's starting to get a little bit back to normal, but it's just, yeah, like you said, you're doing nothing but a disservice to your own region. And when you, I don't know, it didn't sit well, and I'm glad that he lifted the ban, but even so, like at Big House 4, Nintendo either got 17th or 13th with no wobbling, which is still, even with wobbling, that's still damn impressive to get that far. To sort of use that argument as a crutch, well, like, oh, they can only do it with wobbling. We're basically destroying half of an entire neutral game every time someone selects his character or whatever. I just think they're sort of, you know, straw man arguments that there's ways to beat it, right? We still have never seen an Ice Climbers win a national, let alone like a major. So I don't get it. I don't get people calling for the wobbling ban, but.
Yeah.
See.
I mean, the only circumstance I could see it kind of being an issue is like if you're, let's say you have like a brand new local where like 2/3 of the people are like brand new, mm-hmm. and you have wobblers, and just for the encouragement of community growth and very like at a weekly possibly, or like, I don't know, a bar tournament that's supposed to be for fun, then I could possibly see a case for that. Because mm-hmm. like, let's say there was a person that actually messaged me about this. I forgot what country he's from, but basically their scene is small, and like 2/3 of their community of their small community quit because of wobbling or something.
Oof.
And so when you have those kind of extreme circumstances, I can kind of see where like, is it better that we have wobbling or no scene? And like, if you're at that point, then I can kind of see where like
That sucks if, if you're at that sort of, that's like the ultimate, in one, your entire competitive scene or wobbling. That's tough. It sucks that you have to be in this situation, but I understand.
But that's like a really extreme case that I can, I need to look up in my emails because like somebody was like talking to me about it. So that's my opinions on wobbling. And then what was it like? Because I wasn't, you know, I was obviously commentating. I was not in the audience and I was not on Twitch chat. So I don't really know what to make of the whole like Guilty Gear thing because I just finished my commentary session and then I read Twitter. I'm just like, okay, like what just happened?
Yeah, honestly, I mean, it was difficult for me. So I actually missed the very beginning. So this is a pretty uninformed topic for me, but it sounds like there are definitely some pretty large figureheads that are pretty adamant that it was incited by the MC. So was it the same MC for everybody or was it different MCs for different games? Do you remember?
It may have been Jib Bailey.
Okay. Cause like, yeah, you know, if someone says to me, like, are you ready for Melee? Then absolutely I'm going to get buck wild for Melee. So I understand if that was actually asked of them, then there's no way you can fault them for that. Because that's just rational human response. And then for the other end where they were booing Guilty Gear, you know, I want, like, from a non-biased perspective, it's possible that we could have been booing, right? We've done it before. We did it at Apex 2015. We did it at 2014. So it's very possible. I would like to believe that what Juggle Guy and like Hugs are saying is 100% true. But I don't know. I can't say. I wasn't there, and it was obviously difficult from watching at home to get a real feel for what was happening. So
that's fair. Yeah. I think you know what I get out of this is like this is one of the few times where I'm probably gonna give the Melee scene, you know, the benefit of the doubt. Whereas, you know, the Apex incident, like I was there, and I'm like, okay, yeah, we kind of suck at times.
That was bad. Yeah. There's no way around. Apex was really shitty of us.
Yeah. And so I guess for me, I mean, I think the way like I kind of mitigate these situations because it's a gray area. What I heard was the Guilty Gear guys didn't hear the MC, so it kind of looks like their game is getting booed at face value.
Mm-hmm.
But I think what I'm going to be writing an article on this, and I'm just basically going to say, like, if you're at a cross-cultural event that's just not Smash, like, make an effort to get to know people from other scenes so that you can garner street credibility and the benefit of the doubt. Because, like I'm just kind of trying to picture that one Guilty Gear guy that made top 8. Like, what if he knew, like, 20 Smash players that he, like, ended up being cool with? Then he's probably going to give more of the benefit of the doubt and say, like, Smashers are cool. Yeah. Like, they've been really chill with me. Like, I'm going to assume that some circumstance happened that would cause them to boo. That's not just because it's Guilty Gear.
And so something that I do have to touch on that you were obviously unable to see was Twitch chat was vile. During Guilty Gear, absolutely like horrendous, just really shitty, very abrasive, looking for Melee as soon as possible, you know. And so if you're just watching at home and you're tuning in Guilty Gear for fun, you're a Guilty Gear supporter, and you come into that looks really bad on us. So from the in-person perspective, it probably was fine, but there's no denying that it was bad. Twitch chat, I mean, obviously Twitch chat is always shitty. But especially so during Guilty Gear, and it was definitely worse than usual.
Yeah, and I think part of it is, you know, like first of all, like the game's delayed, so I can understand why people are upset. I mean, I think similar circumstances happened at Apex 2015, where like people were getting irate because like it was already midnight before Melee singles final started or top 8. But I think what we could do, I mean, I think from a TO event organizer standpoint, is just to make it very clear when it's actually starting. So, like, I think that was an issue at the venue, too, because Melee players were starting to sit at 8 o'clock, and then they didn't realize that it wasn't actually going to start till 10:30.
Yeah.
So I think it was just kind of like a mix of logistics that doesn't really create a favorable environment for, like, healthy interactions between people. It doesn't excuse the actions themselves, but like I think that could help mitigate it.
Yeah, and I also for a long time too, and this has been the case at a lot of major tournaments, is that the Twitch chat was severely undermodded. And I think that multiple tournaments in a row, going back, like, get on my level for a long time, like, it was at, like, 35,000 viewers and had, like, 6 mods, which is unacceptable. Then for, like, low-tier city for a good part, too, they didn't have that many mods. And then CEO, until they brought in pretty much the entire Stream Monster backroom, was also modless. And I think if you are anticipating this tournament, and you're going to get in the 5 digits, you know you're going to get over 10,000 Twitch viewers, you need to be prepared for this. Whether it's consulting different people from different games, because you know the CEO is going to be streaming a lot, or, there's a plethora of good mods in the Smash community if you're doing just Smash, but I think that's something that we can do a better job of being proactive with as tournament streamers.
Yeah. And we have a Twitch Stream Monster army of good people.
Yeah, they're great. They were all great. To have them all sort of volunteer and be good, like, they got in immediately when Melee started and just cleaned up. Like, they were Dingo, Fluins, Alex Reitz, who else? Like, Mordfell, Ashcon, all those guys who have a lot of experience just going in and taking care of business. They did a great job, and it was... If they had just been modded from the beginning, then maybe we wouldn't have gotten such quite a vile reaction from Twitch chat. We would have been able to sort of keep it a little clear, new beta tester, etc. So, yeah. Just things.
I mean, yeah, they're good people, and I suppose, supposedly I hear they have a Twitch... I wonder what they're going to do at Evo, because supposedly the Twitch stream monsters have their own mansion for Evo.
It doesn't exist.
it doesn't exist?
According to every stream monster that's currently in your chat, it doesn't exist.
It doesn't. Okay, it doesn't exist. All right, that's fair.
No, they're all great, and it definitely does exist, but they do a great job, and they are rarely thanked for something that is pretty essential, so I appreciate it.
It's good stuff. What was it? So, yeah, I think that's like going to be my solution. I think that's actually important that a large event organizer puts like some resources into. It's just making sure that the chat experience could be a little bit better with modding, or just like an extra responsibility that they can delegate to a handful of people.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. So what are your thoughts about like going into the summer? We've seen our first semi-big event. What the Fox is coming up this weekend. I think registration ends in like 45 minutes.
So who we got there? Armada's going to be there. Mango is doing a sub goal, of course, to see if he goes. Leffen? Is Leffen going?
Do you know? I think he was deciding between... I would like to say he is, but... It's kind of interesting how, like, out of the blue, let me actually look it up on some...
It's one of those tournaments where it's ridiculously stacked at the top 25, and then it just plummets from there.
Last year, it wasn't even like that. It was, like, the four best, four gods, and then, like, Wizzy, Dark Atma, West Bolt.
And this year, it's, like, the same sort of thing, but also you can add Duck is going...
There's a lot of people going to this, actually.
Yeah.
So Armada, Hungry Box, Mango, Mutaking, West Bulls, S-Fat, Drug Fox, Wizzy, Duck, Cobol, Moon.
So see, that's like all amazing top 30 players. And then who's like the next player after the Moon?
He's not very good.
Yeah, like there's a
Prince of Boo. I'm just kidding. Yeah, he's pretty good. Prince of Boo.
Prince of Boo.
And then Disc Kid's back.
Yeah, but there's like there's just a gap, right? It's like, it's going to be an amazing top 8, but top 32 will be just a snoozer, right? It's going to be these players just whomping on significantly lesser players until we start getting...
like top 16. Probably,
yeah, I was going to say top 16. Yeah, because you have... Let's see. So you have...
Draven's like the 16th seed here.
Yeah, 4 of the top 5, Wes... S-Fat 6, Drug Fox 7, 8, Dark 9, is it 10? Moon 11. Yeah, so the moon is 11, and then Prince of Boo's 12. Dark Gamma would be 13. Diz would be 14. Face Roll 15. Drefin 16. But, like, even those matchups, like, you have to go to, like, 8, 9 directly. You'd have to go to, like, Duck versus Wizzy or Duck versus Kobol, because Armada's going to stomp Drefin. Hungry Box is going to stomp Face Roll. Diz is going to get whooped by Mango. Like, it's, and then you just, you
dude, start, what if this kid beats Mango?
Don't even bring that. Don't even, why would you even say that? Why would you even say that? That's not happening. For the love of God, that would be one of the worst things to ever happen. I love Kyle. Love Kyle. If he were the ice climbers that were to do it, that were to beat Mango, that would set off this unbelievable chain. Like, everything that we just talked about via wobbling would be pretty much erased.
Like, they'd be what, like, if, no. You know what our line was on, like, whether or not, like, we concluded wobbling's probably too good? Hmm. No offense to this kid, but we concluded that if this kid ever won a major, that's, like, kind of where the line drew in our minds. That wobbling might be too good.
I agree for the most part. I love Kyle, and he'll be the first person to tell you that his game plan revolves around wobbling. But I mean, I actually had the pleasure of commentating one of the closest sets that Mango's had with an Ice Climbers, where he played Nintendo to Big House 5, and it was last stock game 5. And it was, like, my co-commentator and I were like, we thought this would be a 3-0. This was, you know, Nintendo is really holding his own. He did a 3-stock comeback game 1.
I remember that.
Yeah, and just, it came down to the wire, and I think since then, Mango just hasn't been touched. I think press art was before that, but we saw him do dirty things to Fly. We saw him do dirty things, especially dirty things to Nintendo, to Genesis. But if all of that were to just be taken, just poof, gone by one loss to Diz Kid Boogie, that would be next level. That would be a catastrophic event in Melee history.
It's kind of like, this is kind of like a really bizarre analogy, but I feel like Diz Kid Boogie is like the PM of Melee players. Like, if he gets too big, like, something about him will get banned. Like, he can be good.
Really good. That is a very random but good analogy.
Like, he can be good to a certain point, but if he gets to a certain point, there's going to be outrage, and he's probably going to get banned somehow. Yeah. And that's the way
he is, like, the nicest dude.
He is. But you know that's like the reality, right? Like, the discussion will be going on that we should probably be wobbling if it ever got to that point.
Yeah, which is sad. But I think we have enough talented players where it won't. And actually, Diz and I had a conversation a couple weeks ago about what he was trying to do this summer. He was like, hopefully I'll win a tournament soon, but every time I go somewhere, so is Kobol. Because he knows that Kobol just has his number. So that should be our plan. If this kid starts getting dangerously close to winning majors, we should just start rigging brackets so that he has to play Kobol really early and then make it so that they have to play in losers again.
Well, what if he brings Kobol so that he keeps getting second place so that it doesn't get banned? Have you ever thought about that?
Damn, Tafo, you're taking me to the next level. You're taking me way beyond where I was thinking.
You don't know. That extra nice feature about this kid could be all, like, an elaborate ploy, and he could be all playing us. And then he's going to win Evo this year and then run away. That was his plan all along, to lurk in a corner.
That's come on, Tim. That's some Smash Illuminati shit. You just told everybody part of the script, Tafo. I don't know about that.
I don't know, man.
All right, so what are you looking forward to? Who are you expecting really big things from? Like, let's look at the next 3-month period, starting with Evo and ending with Big House. So you have the 4 big tournaments, I think. Evo, Smash Con, Shine, and Big House. Who are you expecting to see big leaps from? I'm curious.
That's a good question. I think I think honestly at this point it's not a matter of who makes a leap, because I think anyone from like 7th to 25th or whatever you want to draw the line at has shown potential to like have like top 10 level skill. It's just going to be like who can be the most consistent, and I think that's going to be the story of the summer, right? Because like you can get like 1/5 place, you know, at a big tournament, that's good and all, but like it kind of washes out if you get like 33rd at the like two other tournaments.
Yeah, well, like what did Laudanis get as CEO?
He didn't do that bad. He got 13th.
That's actually pretty good.
Yeah, he lost to Wizzy and Axe. Very respectable losses.
Huh. That's really good. I guess I didn't see him like play at all. That's actually very good. So that's my point.
And his loser bracket one's pretty good. I know that he eliminated Gravy and Nun in losers. I forget who else he played against.
He beat two Falcons?
Yeah.
What a... When can we put the meme to rest, Sam? When can we?
I mean, he did lose to Wizzy in winners, for what it's worth.
Yeah,
but it was really funny because on Friday night when it was just friendlies after the pools ended, I look over and I glance over to Laudanis, who's playing Nun in a money match, and I see like I just see the end of it, and it was Nun having four stocks left to Laudanis' zero, and I was just like, "What the hell's wrong with you with Falcon that like this is happening?" And he's like, "I don't know, man. Like, Falcon's really broken. Like, I can't do anything."
I just think he just needs to remember that at his last two majors he beat Gatsu, S2J, and now Gravy and Nun. Right? He's beaten four Falcons in the last two runs that he's had. So he just needs to stop whining and remember that, oh yeah, I'm Sheik. Like, I can beat this character.
There are certain points where I'm like, I don't... And correct me if I'm wrong. You get the sensation sometimes with Prince Abu, right? There's a point where like the meme consumes him so much that I'm not sure if they are the meme or if they are memeing. Or like... if they're serious or not, basically.
You know where that point happened for Michigan is KJH and Falco. So KJH obviously like became it to the point where people would start talking to him about Falco rather than him complaining about Falco. And now he he's taken sets from Wes. So he's no slouch in the matchup, but it doesn't matter how he could beat like Zoo, Wes, PPMD in a row, and then he gets back to Grants and PPMD 6-0s him with Falco, and everybody would just forget. They'd be like, oh, classic KJH Falco. Like, he's good at the matchup, and just like Sam is good against against Falcon, it's just the perception where, yeah, they've just been engulfed, right? I think it's tough. And they did it to themselves, right? They have nobody to blame but themselves. So that's just the way it is. And I next tournament we'll see Laudanis beat he'll beat Wizzy and he'll beat Nun.
I had two dinners this weekend where Prince Abu, KGH, and I think Laudanis was actually at one of the dinners.
Oh yeah, you got to hang out with the Goon Squad because K's there too.
I couldn't take it, man. Can I tell you about my dining experience on Friday night? It was like the worst.
Oh my god. I actually am really glad that you said that. I think individually they are all great, but when they are together, they are insufferable. Absolutely insufferable.
Yes. And on top of it off, the diner we went to didn't give us our food until like 90 minutes in. Oh, and they forgot my order after 90 minutes.
Oh,
I was not in a good mood, man. And I got so upset that I told the waitress, like, hey, like, I don't want my food anymore. Like, just cancel the order.
Jesus.
And, like, I gave her attitude, too. And, like, I rarely do that, but extreme circumstances call for extreme measures, man.
Oof. And just, meanwhile, you hear...
Well, I just hear opinion after opinion... Shit. Like, Laudanis is, like, crying out how much of an up-and-comer he is and how I'm the worst analyst ever. Prince Abu is, like, talking about, like, character matchups and how bad Mango is at the game, and I don't even...
It's not funny. I honestly don't think it's funny. I'm in a minority because everybody thinks that shit is hilarious, but I just get pissed off when I hear shit like Puff loses to Samus. Just, like, shut up.
Dude, you know, One night. Principally is a funny guy individually. Like,
yeah.
He, he's great, so. But at Smash Summit 2, I wanted to sleep, and he Toph graciously let him sleep in our hotel room. But he screamed, "I am Dwan Energy McDaniel," until 3 a.m.
Yeah.
From 1 a.m. to 3 a.m., he kept yelling, "I am Dwan Energy McDaniel." The lights were turned off already. Toph somehow, I think, knocked out, or he occasionally left the chuckle, and I cannot get any sleep.
I'm so sorry. It's the whole, it's what you said, right? It's the meme that's engulfed him, and now he has to, like...
And then, what was it? And what's so funny is how everybody associates the Goon Squad. So, like, there's a funny story where Hungrybox is coming out of the hotel room, or, like, the elevator, and it's me, Toph, and Prince Abu. But... Hungrybox, associating the Goon Squad for the Goon Squad, thought I was Duck.
Oh.
Because naturally, it's like, oh, who's Prince Abu hanging out with an Asian guy with glasses? Oh, of course, it must be Duck. Oh my gosh.
H-Box did that?
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Ugh. Dude, that's its like own story of Asians getting mistaken for other Asians.
Oh yeah, I saw at Evo last year, I was hanging out with actually, it might have been Prince. It was like me, Prince, and Dark Atma. And D1 comes up to us and he goes, "What's up, Keizu?" to Dark Atma. And Binyu just goes, "Nope, I am not Keizu." And then D1's like, "Oh, yeah, my bad. Dark Atma." Like, it was after I was sitting there, like, oh my god.
Dude, I think one of the funny stories is at Pound 4 or 5, where Wobbles walks up to L. Alvin, NorCal, Foxman. And it was after, like, Zoo did something. And he had a full conversation with Alvin, thinking that he was Zoo. And he was like, "Oh, like, good stuff, man. Like, I was really impressed." And Alvin, I don't think, had the heart to tell him that he wasn't Zoo. So he kind of just, like, played along with it.
Hugs tweeted out that happened to Kalamazoo at CEO. Where someone, like, came up to him and, like, asked for an autograph or something, asked for a picture, thinking it was Zoo. But it was Kalamazoo. It's like, how do you fuck that up?
It's so bad. Yeah. I think there's like a Asian squad that gets mistaken for each other. So if I were to name names, there's Zoo, Dark Atma, Alvin, Ty.
Yeah.
Kalamazoo.
Even Swedish a little, kind of, in that group. Like, I think someone confused Swedish with Keizu, or Keizu for Swedish. But, you know, it's kind of fucked up because we're talking about, like, that actually happens. Can you imagine if we were like, oh, yeah, Shroomed, Allen, D1. Like, that's fucked up. That's fucked up.
Allen, imagine if I called him, dude, you know Allen, right?
Yeah.
Dude, imagine if I called Allen Prague. Or, like, someone random. Like, he knows I'd be trolling at that point, but, like, what if somebody random... So, like, Alan said, like, "Oh, hey, Prague."
Yeah.
It's actually, like, really funny, though. Whenever it happens. I think there's one instance where... I forgot who did this, but he was talking to Kalamazoo. And then he turned around because somebody called that person that was talking to Kalamazoo. And he turned around and talked to someone else. As if that person was Kalamazoo. Like, within a 10-second stretch. Like, he just, like, turned around and flipped 360 and then talked to the wrong person that he thought was Kalamazoo.
Oh, my God.
Dude.
We need to wake up. Stay woke, Smashers.
Dude, how can we troll Hugo in this?
We can talk about Hugo's bracket. Right?
You mean where he lost to Gatsu and that was that?
Yeah. He had a rough CEO, man.
He beat Shroomed and then beat some fraudulent player and losers at that point because of how the brackets worked, and then he lost to Gatsu.
Yeah. But, like, so he had, like, this huge summer plan, right? He, like, went sober for a long time. He's like, "I'm going to take names at Gommel. I'm going to do amazing." And I don't even think – he hasn't even come close to cracking a top eight. At Gommel, at CEO, and he even lost. He got flown out to Rubicon, and he lost to KJH twice.
Wait, he went to Rubicon 11 or whatever?
Yeah, he lost to KGH twice.
Oh, damn.
Yeah. And I think it was 6-1, too. Like, it was not close. And it's funny. So, that was, like, right when I was starting to, like, get to know Hugo. It was around SmashCon last year. And I just see multiple $20 bills being thrown down between he and Kalindi. And Kalindi was just cleaning him out. And so, I just started joking around with him, like, Kalindi, like, how does it feel knowing that your entire SmashCon trip has been funded by Hugs? And Hugs would just get really tilted. And then they flew him out for a region, like a semi-regional in Michigan. I think it was like not landlocked. Frostbite? Something like that.
Oh, Wes Bowles that hosted, by the way. Thanks. Appreciate it.
Nice. Thanks, Wes.
Anyway, do tell.
So he beats Kalindi in winners. And before the tournament, Kalindi tweeted out, if I lose to Hugs, I'm deleting my account. And then Kalindi double eliminates him. Or, like, beats him in losers or beats him in grands or whatever. And he just says, my Twitter lives to see another day. And to this point, I'm pretty sure Kalindi is, like, 11-1 in all money matches, tournament sets against Hugs.
Wait, so you're telling me he has a better record than me now?
I guess. Like,
gosh, dang it.
That's the thing. So that was another thing. Esam and Kalindi played in winners finals of their CEO pool. And back in November, I have no idea how it came up. Because Kalindi was doing his meme shit, bitching about Samus on Twitter. And Esam chimes in like, oh, you're like just as dumb for getting hit by Wave Dash back down smash. And Prince Abu fabricates a $100 money match. I'm like, oh, I'll bet $700,000 on KJH. And Esam's like, oh, if I had that much money, I'd bet it on myself. And I say, $50. He goes down. This is in November. And I tweeted him at CEO. I'm like, Esam, you owe me $50. And he PayPal'd me $50.
Man of his word, man.
5 months. I'm like, yo, he just doesn't lose to Samus. And I think it's hilarious that Hugo thinks he can beat Kalindi. I would love to see KJH versus Plup Samus. I think that would be a really fun set to watch.
I think so.
I don't know if we'll ever see it.
I love the matchups where both players are clearly experienced against the other character. I think those are like the best.
Yeah.
Because you can't gimmick your way out. You can't exploit the lack of matchup knowledge. No, you know everything inside and out. It's just like who can truly outplay their opponent.
Yeah. And so KJH beat Plup at Apex 2015. That was Plup's first ever real tournament set where he went Sheik and KJH beat him 2-1. So it was right after Swedish beat his Samus.
Yes, I remember that.
Yeah, and so just since then, right, everyone from Michigan, even at that tournament, was hoping that we would finally see KJH versus Plup Samus, but we still have not seen it. And I think it would be one of the better matchups because we saw even with the switch against SFAT, SFAT surprisingly played very well against the Samus. Most notably with the four stock comeback. I actually want to hear your thoughts on that commentating. So that was the first set that we've ever seen SFAT and Plup play, pretty much, right?
Yeah. I thought Plup was honestly going to go Samus from the get go because I just thought that SFAT was going to run over his Sheik. And
yeah. Because he played back to. That was. Another thing, sorry to cut you off again, when Mewtwo King trolled everybody by hand-warming Marth and then switched to Sheik, we were like, what are you doing? He just beat back-to-back amazing Sheiks, right? He had beaten Dewan, he had beaten Plup, and Mewtwo King's like, oh, I think I'm going to go Sheik. And just he got...
And then he loses.
He got stopped, yeah. You're like, oh, okay.
Yeah, I'm like... He does this against Mango too, and I'm just you're throwing a game every time you do this. Just go Marth.
Yeah.
I mean, I thought Ons Plup was. I thought Ons Plup went to if Plup went Samus from the get go. I thought Plup was gonna win. SFAT, you know this. I mean, you know your Michigan history. SFAT's yep. Never really done well against Duck.
Yeah.
And so I thought that. Well, hey, let's. If he goes Samus, I think it's done for SFAT, who regularly loses people like Daryl all the time. And I'm just there's no way he can really win that. So that really surprised me. I mean, I think the four-stock comeback, I can't imagine like anybody ever doing that against a Samus out of all characters, just given how Samus works. It was insane. And I think like that just killed any kind of hope or momentum for Plup there. Because like, how are you going to come back?
Yeah, you can't do that. You can't come back when you get reverse four-stocked like that. That's tough. But I mean, that, like, and we sort of, like, we touched on it earlier. We sort of resigned the fact that he looked done against Axe when he went down 2-0. So, you know, there's a little bit of hope. Like, all right, you know, he did the Plup laugh, right? Where he laughs as if it's funny, but inside, you know, he's just pissed. He's like, what the fuck just happened?
I think that's a good way to put it, man.
Yeah, he does it all the time. But like when something, except Wobbling, where we saw him flip the double bird. But like he does that laugh all the time. It's a Plup laugh where he sees something stupid that happens to him. Like when Mango side B spiked him at Genesis, he just started laughing. And you know, it's just like, that's not funny, dude. That sucks to lose like that. That sucks to have four stock comeback against you. He just laughs. I'm like, to each his own, man. Everyone has a way of coping with it. So
he's like the Ned Flanders, right? And eventually there's going to be like one day like where it just all snaps.
Yep. Yep. I don't want to be there for that day, man. It's going to be gross.
It is. Oh, my gosh. But credits to Mutaking. I mean, I've said this before, like, you know, once you're at a certain level, the expectations are on you that people will always point out the exception to the rule as if, like, you're really bad. And I think that's what we do with Mutaking. But it's not a fair standard to have that we don't apply that to the same people that we're comparing to Mutaking to say, like, oh my gosh, this player is so good that we kind of dismiss, like, their bad losses. And, you know, Mutaking's still, like, phenomenally good getting second here.
Yeah, you shoved off everybody that tried to win. So what was his run? He beat none, which was a nice little vindication win. Honestly, if you didn't see that coming, like Mutaking winning that, then you're an idiot. Then what? He played. Who did he play in quarters? Do you remember? He played Shroomed, and he stomped Shroomed. And then he played Plup, and that was an amazing set. But he still was able to come out on top. And then he fended off SFAT and losers. So he beat three of, arguably, depending on how you feel on SFAT, three of probably like the top 11, 10 players in the world.
And yeah. He also beat Chu, which I think went under the radar.
Yeah, that's true, especially after Chu's ridiculous losers run. He had a great tournament. And he's, you know, even with the, on the heels of the double elimination from Swedish, he's still showing that, like, he's still easily one of the five best players active right now. Probably like he's the fifth, right? He's the fifth best player that's active right now. And there's no argument on either side. I would love to see him pull off, especially because we best of three, and he'll probably be seeded against Leffen, maybe. Probably he'll be seeded against Leffen in quarters at Evo, right? 4-5. Do you agree? What do you think?
I would say so.
Yeah. So that, if he wins that and then gets, that's like a momentum springboard. He plays Armada and he can beat Armada. And then look at that. You're sitting in winners finals. And then Mango and HBox have been going, you know, back and forth recently. And this is obviously if everything breaks perfectly. This is probably not going to happen. But it could, you know, we've seen crazier things happen. So I would love to see a resurgence from Mutaking. I don't think he'll win Evo. I don't even think he'll get top four, but I would love to see a little bit of magic from him. Yeah. So.
You prefer the magic.
I do prefer the magic. I'm a big,
it's kind of tough. And I always say the statistic, but in about almost a decade now, he's only won one event that featured two other gods or more. And that's Big House 3.
Yeah.
And so I don't know what it is. I mean, he's gone a lot of second and thirds, like in a stretch where, like, you know, five of the gods were at an event, but can't seem to win an event where there's two other gods for whatever reason.
Yeah. It's a shame. Like, he just has these spurts of brilliance, but he just can't. And this is, so we can let the stream know, we talked about if you should write the article on his struggles and losers, right?
Yeah.
And it's, he still sort of has them. He did a much better job of staying out of losers as CEO, but, you know, he lost to, he had to make a little bit of a run at Smash or Splash, couldn't do it. Couldn't do it at, what was another tournament where he sort of got knocked in losers early? Where else has he been? He's been everywhere. But, you know, he's had the struggles. There's been no other way of getting around it. He's been really sub Mewtwo King in losers. And so he has to get the ball rolling early in winners. Because if he loses to Leffen in quarters at Evo, he's done. He's getting like seven. He's going to drop down. He'll probably have to play some really talented player. He might squeak out a set win. And then he'll have to play one of like Axe, West Balls.
Well, what if it's like an Ice Climbers?
Yeah, and he might lose that. Sonic Genesis, you never know. So I think it's important to notice for Mewtwo King specifically, and this is one of your better articles, is that he needs to stay in winners. So we'll see. We'll see if he can do it. But who knows, man.
Yeah. I think the format of best of three actually hurts Mewtwo King more than anybody else because he doesn't get FD anymore.
Yep.
And so it's going to be tough. And it's just, I think it's more of a credit not to Mewtwo King getting worse. I wouldn't really say that per se, but it's more so everybody like kind of catching up.
Yeah.
Which is unfortunate.
It's been a rapid improvement from everybody, and it's made all these Melee tournaments so much fun to watch, man. It's just. The way it is.
You know, do you ever do fantasy, not like fantasy Smash, but like actual like fantasy sports?
Oh yeah, I've been in the same fantasy football league for 8 years now.
Okay. So yeah. You have an up and coming player and a veteran that's kind of on the downhill. Like, and you have to make that tough decision, right, on potential and where they are right now.
Mm-hmm.
For like a draft. Do you pick Gatsu or Hugs if you had a fantasy draft first?
Am I drafting for one tournament or am I drafting for the next five tournaments?
The next five.
Gatsu. I love Hugs, but I think he is showing a pretty clear improvement rate. While ever since Hugs was ranked 20th, he hasn't really put any sort of serious, like notable improvement going up from 20. Right? He hasn't, other than beating S-Fat at Battle of the Five Gods in a meaningless set, for him, at least, other than, like, Vindication and multi-tournament conditioning, he hasn't beaten anybody seriously amazing in a long time. And Gatsu is getting there. So I think if you... I don't know what Gatsu's going to. And also, this is because I think Gatsu goes to, you know, Hugs goes to SSSs and Mayhem sometimes, but not all the time. But Gatsu is there every Tuesday, right? He just beat Lucky at the tournament tonight. I don't know if you're following. Yeah, he just beat Lucky. Like, he is putting in the work. He's going to these weeklies where he's playing against top 25 players. He's playing against Wizzy. He's playing against Plup. He's playing against Colbull. And Hugs, instead of actually practicing, he's sitting there shaving his legs on stream, which is hilarious, and it's what... You know, it's what pays the bills, but it's if you're giving me five tournaments, I'm taking Gatsu.
What about Swedish or Ice?
Ooh, that's a good one. I think Ice still, just because even though he really obviously doesn't have the like means to go to that much, he's been sort of holding court, right? He got 7th at Genesis. We got either, what do you get, 9th or 7th at Smash Summit, where he beat Pew Pew Yu. And then he does what he's supposed to do in Europe. He got 2nd at DreamHack, beating Prof Pro, losing to Leffen. And I don't think we have seen enough. Wait, did Ice lose? Did he actually lose to Leffen's Mewtwo in tournament?
No, he didn't lose that game.
That's what I thought. Okay. Like, I don't know. That's a great question, just because we've seen Swedish at a lot more data points, and he's been playing extraordinarily well, where we haven't seen as much from Ice. But I still think if you are giving me next five tournaments and Ice has the ability to go to all five, I think Ice would have a better, higher average placement. So, by the slimmest of hairs, I'm going with Ice.
All right. Here's another interesting one. Diskit Boogie or Wobbles?
Whoo! Man! Wow. It's so hard to tell with Wobbles, right? We don't know if we're getting serious try-hard Wobbles or if we're getting purposefully non-wobbling, going, you know, letting Axe play four different characters against him at Forte 4 or whatever. Ugh. That is hard.
Because this kid also took a set off of Mewtwo King recently, too.
Yeah. Honestly, five tournaments? Because this also scrubbed it up against... He didn't make bracket at Big House 5. Pretty sure he did pretty poorly at Genesis. But then he...
But then Wobbles also did poorly at Genesis,
yeah,
too.
Yeah. Give me Diz.
It's a tough one, right?
That is really difficult. That's more difficult than Ice and Swedish. I feel much better about Ice than I do about Diz. I think peak Wobbles is still much better, and I think Diz would be the first person to tell you that. But are we seeing peak Wobbles anytime in the next five tournaments?
That's fair. Let me think of another one that's going to be interesting.
These are great. I love these questions.
DJ Nintendo or Crush?
Crush. That's like that.
That
I
quick?
I think Crush will be top 50 by the end of the year. I think he's so good. And he's gotten so close to getting these huge wins. He was up against Nintendo to Pound. He was up against Mewtwo King at DreamHack. And part of it's maybe just from inexperience, from nerves, from his age. He's only 18 or whatever. But give him more tournament experience and he'll be getting the huge wins. So I would go with Crush in a heartbeat.
Here's an interesting one. And some people in their like kind of contemporary rankings, like keep in mind very, very, very recent bias. So I'm going to put an asterisk here. Don't crucify me, chat.
Okay.
KGH or Silent Wolf?
Ooh. Silent Wolf, but he has to go to the five tournaments, right? We have to see. But I still think, I still think Silent Wolf would have a higher average placement. Just because Kalindi hasn't put together the he does well at the regionals and the locals. You know, he's Farmer Henderson. He doesn't lose Michigan locals. He's had Swedish, he's had Kobol, he's had who else? Duck, obviously. He doesn't lose Wednesdays in Michigan. He just doesn't lose. Like, there's a joke in Michigan where Mango can win two Evos, but can he win a U-meme? Can he win the tournament where Kalindi is like 15-0? But he hasn't put it together at a national yet. He hasn't, you know, he beat Kirby Kaze at Genesis. And then lost to Plup, and then immediately lost to PPU for 33rd. That's a tough bracket. CEO, he lost to SFAT, who he has now played three majors in a row, by the way. And then he lost to... He beat Kalamazoo, and then he lost to... I can't remember who he lost to. Do you remember who he lost to?
With who?
Who Kalindi lost to as CEO.
He lost to SFAT and Axe for like 17th or something ridiculous.
Oh yeah, the Axe set where that was a heartbreaker. Did you see the ending of that?
I didn't get to.
So like, it's last stock game three, and he is like recovering And he air dodges in to, like, try and get sort of, like, a wave land or whatever. And it's too low, and he, like, clashes with the ledge and falls to his death.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, it was a heartbreaker. So he could have done it, and he actually almost did it, too, at Full Bloom, where he got third to Lucky and Axe. I'm pretty sure he got double eliminated by Axe. But I still think Silent Wolf is just a little bit of a significant notch above Kalindi. I would love to see KGH just bust out like a top eight run. We still have not seen KGH in top eight of a major, right?
Yeah.
We've seen Silent Wolf there multiple times.
Do you pick Wizzy or Coble?
Wizzy.
Okay, that was quick.
I think that kid is on his way to top 10. He's getting there. He's getting so good. And he already is amazing.
So, who are you picking seventh?
Oh my god. Axe.
You're picking Axe? Yeah. Okay.
I think it's safer pick than Wes. But a higher peak than like Shroomed and Lucky and S-Fat. I think if I'm going right now, I think I go Axe 7, Wes 8, S-Fat 9, Dewan 10, Wizzy 11, Lucky 12.
Okay. Dude,
that's just like right. That's off the dome, right? That's off the dome. I don't know. They're all so close that they could all feasibly beat each other.
It's one of the. I always say like when you have like a drop off at some point, that's like the worst draft pick that you can have.
Yeah. If I'm drafting in a 10 team league for like the next five tournaments, I want the sixth pick.
I want sixth or fourth.
Yeah, so I get Plup with six, and then I would get the 14th pick. Actually, I don't know. No, I would probably want. Oh, that's tough. Do you value?
You get the 15th pick out of that, I think, in a 10 team.
Yeah, because the person who picks 10th picks 11th, the 9th picks 12th, 8th picks 13th, 7th picks 4th. Yeah, so you get the 15th pick. So maybe not. I think maybe it depends if you want two really high quality players or if you want a god and like
give me
Drug Fox, Coble, Duck, Drug Fox.
Cause I'm getting Leffen or Mingo at the fourth pick.
Yeah.
And like that's so much great value. Because like the worst they get is like fifth, but more often than not they're getting second or third or possibly winning.
And so that I did that strategy for CEO Fantasy. I actually correctly picked the top six. I had HBox, V2 King, S-Fat, Plup, Dewan, and Plup. I had all six of them. And then I had Diz and Lucky at 9th and 13th. And then I had four scrubs. And I didn't even make it on the first page. So it depends on the scoring system, right? Do you want a surefire fifth, probably third or second, and then anywhere from 9th to 25th? Or do you want like a 9th place lock? Possibly could get top 8, but probably won't do worse than 17th, and two of those players.
Well, to be fair, this fantasy draft was really, really shenanigan-y with the brackets and how they work, right? Nightmare getting
17th. Yeah.
A Ricky getting 25th, K-Pan getting 25th. If you look at the bracket paths, it was very disproportionate.
Did you see K-Pan versus Wizzy?
Oh my gosh, that was so bad.
That might be one. That might honestly be the worst choke I've ever seen.
You know, you know, it was really bad. It was really funny. So K-Pan goes back to the pool room, or the room for pools, not like a swimming pool.
Yeah.
And he like takes off his shirt. And just, like, starts, like, screaming repeatedly and, like, fake pretends to try to throw a chair repeatedly before the staff goes in.
Jeez. That was heartbreaking. I I don't think I've ever seen a player come that close to beating a player of that caliber and just choke it. That's like, I don't even know, man. That's like the drive. That's like, oh my God. That's like Vinatieri hitting from 55. That is just brutal. There's like that, because that's like potentially like a career changing win, right? Then everyone knows who K-Pan is. You know, he starts getting some national recognition. Wizzy, you know, who knows what he does in losers. All of the momentum that he's been building for tournaments, 3-4 past tournaments, is gone. And instead, he's like scrapes it out, and then he keeps up the momentum. He gets top 8, top 6. No, top 8. You never mind. Yeah. But that was brutal, man. That was brutal. There's no other way to put that one. Ugh.
Yeah, man, I don't.
Fuck.
I don't know if I've seen a bigger choke than that.
Yeah.
Arguably, maybe Nintendo Music King Game 5. I think that was a pretty awful choke.
It was a bad choke, but I think the talent discrepancy between K-Pan and Wizzy makes up for the, like, just because when you have, and also, like, I'm having trouble trying to formulate how to say, like, when you because you don't get in that situation ever where you have a top 20 player in the world, you're up 2 stocks to 1 clean, and you're edge guarding too, before he gets the ledge, like, just swiped from him, and then he just crumbles. Mewtwo King, also, I'm pretty sure, was it game 5? I could have sworn it was game 4, but either way, like,
he literally, like, for Mewtwo King, he literally just had to float for, like, the next 3 seconds, and he would have won.
Yeah. Ugh.
Was it game 5? I'm gonna look.
I could have sworn it was game 4. Because, I mean, who knows? Hopefully someone in chat will quickly be
like, it was 3-1, so it didn't even matter.
Yeah, that's why I was like, there's something else that there was there that didn't make it that big of a choke.
Okay. That wasn't game 5, that was game 4. You're right.
So I think because it was game 3 and K-Pan is on the on the cusp of one of the biggest smashed upsets of the year, probably one of the biggest in recent memory.
Why is Mewtwo King complaining then? He lost 3-1.
Yeah, he shouldn't have been.
Yeah, okay, that makes it less interesting. I thought it was, the way that it was tweeted out, it made it sound like it was game 5, and that's why I thought it went to game 5. You're right.
That's just Mewtwo King making a Mewtwo King.
That's, okay, now I know.
Yeah. I'm trying to think, like, honestly, that probably was more debilitating than, like, getting reverse four stocked. I would have rather been Plup than K-Pan in those situations. Just because, like, once again, like, S-Fat getting 4 stocks in a row off someone is impressive but not unheard of. But K-Pan beating, not he got a game and then was up 2 stocks to 1 at 130%. Like, that's, ugh. My heart, I can't even say it enough, man. My heart just breaks for the guy. But, yeah. You live and you learn. Hopefully he'll come back at another major soon and give another top 25 player run for the money. But that's the thing, is you probably just won't. You probably won't see him get that close again.
Oh, just, don't say that.
Yeah.
Maybe K-Pan is on the up-and-coming list, just like Ledan is.
Ledan has been up. He's been up. I'm excited for Evo brackets to come out. Are you helping Seed?
You know, I should probably talk to Scamp about that, because I think the due date was like 3 days ago.
Oh, nice.
I wanted to wait till CEO was over.
Gotcha. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Because once they start getting that...
I mean, if I were to like kind of run down the list, let's see. I'd probably do Armada, Hungry Box, Leff, and Mango. And the reason why I swap it is because... Swedish versus Swedish usually is a big complaint.
Yeah, that's
and true. I think 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 are so negligible that it honestly shouldn't make that much of a difference.
I think that I just think whoever, like we talked about it, whoever's the fourth seed is just kind of a little bit tougher, like significantly tougher draw than everybody else because they have to play Music King.
Is Plup not a walk in the park either?
He's not a walk in the park, but I think whomever you go between Leffen and Mango. Actually, no, I think if you have Leffen Plup, then you have the whole Samus dilemma that comes in. But I just think anytime you have to play someone of Mutant Excalibur in quarters is tough.
Yeah.
I would love to see Leffen Plup in quarters. I'd like to see them do. So I think your seeding would work well. I think if they did Mango Mewtwo King 4-5 and then Plup 6, and he'll be playing against Leffen in quarters, and then we might
see. And they'll put like some combination of like Axe West Balls for like 7-8.
Yeah.
And then Esfet, Shroomed. I'd probably toss PPMD at 11 or 12.
If he goes.
Yeah.
I hope he goes, but you never know. We'll see. Yeah, and at that point, then it's just like a clusterfuck. You have like Lucky, Johnny, Wizzy, Drugged Fox, Swedish, who else? Like Duck, Coble.
Silent Wolf?
Yes, Wolf.
Wobbles, Diskid, Nintendude.
One of them's got to get there. It's a rite of passage. We'll see. I mean, I hope it's Nintendo. I like all the Ice Climbers. But if you're going by the metric that both Diz and Nintendo have neither been there yet, and also Nintendo got rocked at last year's Evo, right? He got like 97. He lost to Connor. And then...
Mafia?
Yeah, Moff. Who knows how to play Peach Ice Climbers? He's like the one Peach, apparently, that just decimates Ice Climbers.
Yeah. It's tough, man. I mean, that's where, like, bracket matters.
Yeah, that's a rough bracket. But I'd like to see him make the run, and I think he can do it. And I think he'll be the top-seeded. I hope he'll be the top-seeded Ice Climber just based on results. And... I mean, who knows? Chu could do it again, man. He did it last Evo. He did it at CEO, sort of. I can't believe he got top 8 at CEO. That still is blowing my mind.
Especially considering that he had to play Music King first round of winners.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're pretty good.
Yeah. And then he comes out to Respect Your Elders.
Did you see him versus Alex 19?
I heard it. One game was like a 4% 4 stock.
It's like that's pretty bad.
He does that to people, man. He did that to Chillin at fuck.
Chillin did like 7%.
Yeah, it was 8% four stock. And this is coming from like, MDBA is amazing versus Ice Climbers. Chillin doesn't lose, like he beats Nintendo all the time. He got destroyed by Dizky. I'm pretty sure that was a dream hack. He just has that effect. It's the sort of Dizky effect where you have to be really afraid of him now. I mean, and who knows? Will Fly, is Fly going to Evo? Will he be in good shape?
I don't know what Fly is up to, man. I wish I did. He was randomly in this chatting.
Yeah. I'd love to see him get back into the swing of things. I'd love to see the two players that they're both from SoCal, but I would love to see Fly and Fiction get back into it. I know Fiction had some hand problems, right?
So, yeah, and he's like coding, programming a game right now, so that's like takes his life.
Yeah. But yeah. I mean, if there's any tournament for you to make your comeback at, if you're any player like that, then it's Evo.
Yeah. Dude, watch me like somehow get top 64 at this event and literally complain that everybody sucks at this game if I get top 64. Like, I should not be making brackets at CEO with how little I play. Step it up, everybody. That's like...
The Leffen tweet. Good job, HBox. Everyone else sucks. Damn.
Although Zeus still kicked my ass, and so did Dewan. Dewan obliterated me.
I want to talk a little, since you brought him up, where do you put Zoo for the next five tournaments?
Like 40?
Yeah?
Like 35-ish? Like, am I drafting Mike Hayes or Zoo? And
Mike Hayes.
Like, and Mike Hayes is approximately 35th.
Yeah.
Am I picking Gravy or Zoo?
My Gravy.
So, those are the people that are roughly, like, 35th.
I mean, I'd like to, now that, you know, he'll obviously be busy with Smash GG, but I think that you're in a conducive environment that will allow him to go to a lot more tournaments, hopefully take it a little more seriously. I would love to see a resurgence from Zoo, but, yeah, but you're right. Like, it's sort of, when you see all the players that are around his skill level right now, everybody else seems to be at least trending a little bit upwards, and he's kind of on the...
But to be fair, you know, he moved back to NorCal, I think.
Yep.
And so that's much better than Philadelphia for Smash improvement.
Yeah. Oh, here's a good question. What about Alex 19 or Zoo?
Stealing that from I'm you. Picking Zoo.
Yeah. You don't believe in the magic?
I mean, I think Alex 19 has high, like, he can reward you, and he's a gambly pick.
Yeah. He's that, like, I'm drafting the 29-year-old wide receiver who's missed, like, 15 games in the last three seasons. It's like, I know he has it in him. But will I get a full five tournaments of Alex 19, or will I get 17th, 65th, 33rd, 49th, 25th? Like, yeah. You have no idea where he's going to go.
Definitely. And so that's, like, my tough thing, right? Because... You buy somebody for 33rd and then they get 65th or 97th. Like, that really hurts you.
Yeah.
And I can see Alex getting, like, 65th or 97th more likely than, like, Zoo getting 65th or 97th. But Zoo, you kind of know what you're getting out of him for points. Like, he's probably going to get 33rd at Evo. Maybe 25th. Maybe 49th. Sometimes 17th.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right. I don't see him, like, not making top 64.
Like, he's, like, to me, like, Zoo is, like, a gear check opponent. Like, and while, like, you have gear check bosses where, like, if you're not above a certain skill, you're not beating this guy, and that's yeah. Zoo. Like, if you're not above a certain level of fundamentals, like, you're not going to beat Zoo.
Yeah.
So that's, like, the way I see it.
Yeah. My perception of him was shattered. Like, I was sort of still holding him, like, in a top 30 area until I watched him against Duck. I pound.
Have you seen that set? Gosh.
Damn.
That was
seven. Seven stock.
So Zoo has this interesting thing. Like, if he believes in his heart that the matchup sucks, then he will absolutely get destroyed. Like, if you can almost tell, like, here's the secret. Like, if you're at Evo, right, and it's like top 64. Like, talk to him for, like, two sentences and ask him what he thinks about that matchup he's going to play next. Based on what he says is how you bet.
Yeah.
And for him, he thinks Samus is, like, impossible. He thinks Ice Climbers is impossible. So, coincidentally, he doesn't do very well against both of them. So.
Yeah. Watching amazing players go against matchups that they just have no idea what they're doing. Like, we saw it in Big House 5 against Stuck 2 when Javi got obliterated.
That was so Stuck bad.
Star pick, and then had to go Young Link. And we're like, what? And it's just when you know, like, and Phil pointed this out, when you see a Samus down smash a Fox, and he doesn't go like this, but instead he just goes like that, that's when you know. Like, it's donezo. And even, like, Zoo was doing a lot of smart stuff against Duck, too. He was, like, power shielded lasers back at Duck. But that actually doesn't... So you lose the hit stun property on that, so it's actually costing Zoo.
Yeah.
And it was just a decimation. And thankfully for him now, there's still really only, like... Who would you bet on in a best of five, Zoo or Esam? It's tough.
It's tough, but I feel like Zoo has the anti-ESAM playstyle.
Mm-hmm.
Because Zoo's struggle has always been approaching. Like, if he's forced to approach in a matchup, like, he just doesn't do very well. But ESAM loves to approach, and he loves to go in. So, like, I can see that being close, but I can see, like, Zoo, like, clutching it out just because I don't think he's patient enough. I don't think ESAM's patient enough.
Mm. That'd be fun, though. I think that'd be a fun set to watch.
I think it'd be close, but that'd be interesting. I mean, ESAM, I think, is more than slept on for, like, the amount of results he gets. I think people grossly underrate him. Like, for what it's worth, like, what was it? At low tier city, he did better in Melee than Smash 4.
Yeah, he beat Wobbles.
He did. And, I mean, he has, like, a bunch of wins underneath his belt. Like, if you really look at his profile of wins, like, he's actually doing pretty well for himself in 2016.
Yeah, and at the end of 2015, he beat the moon and tipped off. He got top 8 and tipped off 11. He didn't look like a total scrub at Summit. What you want to take from that? He actually looked pretty good.
I mean, he went even with Armada and Stocks.
He looked especially good against Armada's Fox. He looked very good. And he got a game from Dewan, which Hugs couldn't do at CEO.
Shots.
There's your trigger. There's your Hugo trigger right there.
I mean, it's so easy to trigger Hugo at this point that I feel like it's like at that point where like you're like the high school kid like picking on like the middle school kid that hasn't quite gone through puberty, like you have so many advantages to like just poke fun at him that like I feel really bad.
Which is funny because he's like 40, so it'd be like us being in front of a 40.
I mean, that's like exactly my point. That's like another thing you can poke fun at.
Yeah. All right. Speaking of Hugs, not to trigger him, where are you putting Hugs? For Evo, what do you think?
I mean, he hasn't done well this year. I mean, I don't even know why I put him on honorable mentions. Like, he's not a top 25 player right now.
I agree. I don't think he's there. It's so sad because he, like, had the fire. And then once his, like, we talked about it, once his stream just sort of started devolving into debauchery and Super Smash Brothers Melee, where he's just drinking. Basically, and like it's lame. Like at least for me personally, I would much rather watch Hugo stream than like Armada stream because Armada just sits there in silence and plays. But there's a reason why Armada is still kicking ass and Hugs is losing to Gatsu and to Smash God. You know that doesn't happen when you're taking things really seriously. So
this is a
Melee stream.
Can I name a good win? I mean, he did beat SFAT once at Battle of Five Gods. Kind of scrubbed it up at both Xanadus that he went to.
Yeah.
Didn't do anything at PAL 2016. Didn't do anything at Gommel. What did he do at Genesis?
Lost to Kobol and Losers and squeaked out a win over none in Winners. I can't remember who he lost to. But yeah, he barely beat Chillin. He barely beat none, and then he lost to someone, and then he lost to Kobol for 17. So actually, I did a really in-depth breakdown between Duck and Hugs that's on Reddit somewhere because someone was like, "Oh, you know, it's not fair of you to put Duck so convincingly over Hugs," and I was like, "Well, going back to Big House 5 or going back to Evo 2015 even. So Hugs beat Duck at Evo." And since then, Duck has significantly outplayed both in terms of placings and who he's beaten. So a Big House, Duck beat, like, he beat Swedish, he beat Javi, he lost to Ice, and he lost to a Bait. And then Hugs lost to, like, Alex19 and someone else, I think maybe Dewan, maybe? For, like, 33rd. And then at Genesis, it was sort of a wash. Duck also lost to Kobol, but he was one round later in Losers. And then a DreamHack winner where Duck went off and beat SFAT, Wizzy, MacD, and Leffen, and Hugs got, like, once again, it got like 17th, and then the gap just started widening, basically. Now Duck.
Yeah. Am I comfortable putting Hug? I mean, I think it would trigger Hugo, but like, I'm not comfortable putting him at 32. Like, I would tentatively put it, but I'm not even sure if I like it.
Yeah. I agree. He has the drive. He just needs to find it again, I think. I would love to see, hopefully, the sponsorship. Like, we saw a couple players fall curse to the, like, immediate sponsorship get bodied. But we also saw Anti just win the tournament where he just got sponsored.
But I feel like he's the guy that doesn't give a crap regardless, and I feel like he would just perform however the hell he wants.
Yeah. So here we go. I finally... So going back to Evo, Hugs got 9th, Duck got 13th. Hugs beat Duck and Axe and lost to PPMD and Chu, while Duck beat Fruit Loop, Eddie Mexico, and MacD, and he lost to Hugs and Drug Fox. So I gave the advantage to Hugs there. Then at Big House 5, Hugs beat Milkman, and he lost to Dewan and Alex. I was right. And then Duck beat Alex, he beat Mike Hayes, he beat Javi, and he beat Swedish. And he lost to Ice and Abate. So Duck got 9th, and Hugs got 33rd. So that was a pretty big win for Duck. DreamHack, Hugs beat Android, he lost to Mango and MacD. Duck beat the players I listed, he lost to Tech and Plup. So big advantage for Duck there. And then at Pound, Hugs beat no one. He literally beat Curb, and then he lost to Smash God and Axe, while Duck beat Milkman, Wes, Zoo, and Mike Hayes again, even with the questionable loss to Bizarro Flame, and then he lost to Wizro. So I think there's a huge, huge gap for when people still think that there's, like, to tie Hugs and Duck in together. I think you can't do that anymore, flat out. You have to put Duck in a level of his own, which you did in your rankings. But you're right. I think the days of considering, until we are proven otherwise, considering Hugs a top 25 player.
Like, for us to put us in the same category, like, I think putting Hugs in the same category as Duck is like me putting myself with Ladandis.
Yeah.
Definitely not the case.
Yeah. I don't want to give him the satisfaction, but where are, is Prince Abu a top 32 threat
in Evo?
I agree. He has been incredibly underperforming since his, like, you know, I beat Shroomed at that one Canadian tournament. I beat West Balls, and then, you know, he should have beaten Drug Fox at
Genesis.
It's just, but he choked that away.
He somehow got down thrown like
four. Down throw F smash at like 80 or whatever, and he's died. So, and then he just hasn't done anything. He lost to Diz at CEO, and I personally think Puff Ice Climbers is like almost impossible to lose as Puff. You literally just back air, and you don't touch the ground. And there's a reason why Nintendo and HBox just destroys good ice climbers. So, I don't know. I would like to see Abu. And, you know, I think that he gets all this amazing practice, right? That's what everybody seems to sort of forget about, is that when he's fluffing these players for HBox, he's playing top 15 players for hours on end. And I would love to see him show something for it. But we haven't seen it yet.
Damn. These are major shots.
It's not shots. I want to see Prince do well. I want to see Prince become the Prince that he is. But,
or you want him to become a king.
Yeah, I want King Abu.
Damn. That's fair. I don't know what your in-person relationship is with Abu, so I'm just going to agree with you.
We've gone through some ups and downs, but right now we're cool.
Well, I mean, Prince Abu, I mean, he's a fluffer, and he does a pretty good job of it.
Yep, you proved it, right? Where Armada was like 7 tournaments out of 7 or 6 out of 6 or whatever in sets against HBox when Prince was there.
Yeah, and he's a pretty good commentator.
Yeah, dude, he's so smart. when he actually just like drops the facade and just lays the information on you, I thought his puff commentary at Smash Summit was incredibly good. And I think that if he harnessed that sort of seriousness, then he could really be something great. I mean, and you get what you want out of this game, right? When you tweet about how you're a Winston main in Overwatch, instead of like actively care, I don't know. Prince can do it. I want to see him do it, but until I am proven otherwise, I don't think he'll make top 32.
Damn.
Yeah.
It's so funny. Abu's upset.
I know. He wants to see me make it out of pools. But the difference is Prince Abu's been playing for like 7 years, and I've only been playing for two. And I have made out of pools at majors. So thanks, Prince. I made out of pools at Big House, and I made out of pools at Pound. So thanks. But yeah. He's getting tilted.
It's okay.
But that's what we're doing. We're talking about the state of Melee as it currently stands.
We're being honest.
Yeah, we talked about this, right? If people are legitimately worried about hearing opinions and analysts that they don't want to hear, like, there's a reason why Skip Bayless had like 10 million Twitter followers and everybody would watch First Take, even though he's a goddamn idiot. Because people want to see the opinion, they want to hear the opinion, and it's not baseless, even though he's wrong a lot. Like, you know, it's still worth talking about. And so if Prince is mad, then it's okay, Prince. You can be mad at me, but we're talking real shit. So let's see who I want to pull up, like, the Melee Anatomy, like, 50 to... All right, here, you know, I have my question. I need to look it up. How well do you think Nunn does at Evo?
Depends on whether or not he gets drunk. He lost to me and Bizarro Flame, man. Or me and Eichelman, sorry. Last year.
Really?
Yeah.
Oof.
For, like, 129th or something.
Wow. Really?
Yeah.
Jeez. Oof. All right.
I mean,
that's really bad.
I mean, he said he was drunk or whatever he'd been drinking. So, but that was like the main reason why he like finished 58th was because like that and like another major where he didn't do very well, and like he only attended four. And so if you have like 129th as like one of your
yeah, that results, looks pretty bad.
Or 97th, I'm sorry. I don't know. He could run into Disc and Boogie again. I guess now he has a Ganon to fight against Ice Climbers, but I don't know. I think Nunn fits the top 32. He's had a good 2016. I don't know where I put him. Probably in the, like, if I were to see, like, I'd probably put him in, like, the low mid 20s. I think that's pretty reasonable.
Yeah. You think he's still very clearly, like, he'll be the third best placing Falcon at Evo?
For whatever reason, like, Gatsu and Gravy just don't perform well at, like, Evo.
Yeah.
I don't know what it is, man.
Here's another. Next five tournaments, Wizzy or SUJ?
Picking Wizzy.
I think so too.
That's
a tough, like, sort of shunt to the fans, right? But I think it's sort of showing.
Yeah. I mean, if Wizzy's like, for like every Wizzy seventh place, like SUJ usually finishes like one behind, not like ninth. So it's like, Wizzy's just like performing like one slot better on average. Although this time it was a lot more of a difference with 7th versus 17th, which is like the largest discrepancy. The main reason why I say that is like Wizzy's getting less and less exposed by certain matchups. Like, he's becoming a lot more well-rounded. And why did Gatsu just tweet out Welp as if, like, something bad happened to him?
Maybe he just got run back by Lucky?
I guess so.
I don't know.
You know what I hate about CFL? Like, they put their brackets on, like, a strange site that's, like, really hard to navigate.
Yeah. I noticed that, too. They don't use, like, Smash EG or even Challenge. They, like, use some random site. All right, it's getting kind of late for me. I want to just wrap up a couple more things. I want to talk about... Yeah, so Lucky did bring it back from losers. Where, not just for the next five tournaments, but for how about the rest of 2016 and beyond, where do you put MACD?
I talk to MACD a lot, and honestly, like, he shouldn't have gone to CEO.
Mm-hmm.
And he shouldn't have entered Mayhem. And he's kind of alluded to this on social media, so I think it's not private enough. It's not private to the point where, like, I don't think I can't share it. But the TLDR is that he's kind of been... I would say it's, like, accumulated stress.
Yeah.
And if you know his living situation, like, he lives with 20 other people. And... at Sky's place, and it's really difficult to unwind and relax when, like, you hear noise, like, your roommate's habits are going to bother you, and you don't have a sense of privacy, and it kind of, I think he's reached a breaking point where, like, he just can't tolerate it anymore, and he doesn't have, like, a spot to just, like, unwind. So, like, imagine, like, I guess for the stream chat, like, you have, like, your safe spot, it's, like, your bedroom or whatever where you can unwind, or you have a designated spot where you can just have privacy, and for, like, years, MACD hasn't had that, and he's kind of just reached a breaking point where, like, he can't handle it. I think Splice, he's going to be changing his living situation up ahead, where I think Splice is going to be housing him, and he'll have his own private room.
That's good.
But in the meantime, like, you just talk to him on a personal level, and it's just, like, he's not in a good spot to compete. And I honestly think that... when he moves out, I think everything's going to be good. But it kind of sucks that MACD, like, chose to go to these events, and he's getting more penalized for, like, his last two performances, whereas, like, PPMD, you know, gets the benefit of the doubt for not attending events at, like, not 100%.
Yeah. Yeah, because when people talk about, like, his pound loss to, like, Infinite Numbers, not to discredit Infinite Numbers, but you know, like, damn well that MACD was going through some really intense personal stuff. And it was very visibly affecting him, not only his play, but also just, like, his weekend. Like, so I housed him for pound, and it was, at points, it was tough.
Yeah, and so, I don't know, I think MACD was on such a high note before that instance kind of happened before pound, and I just think the last 3 months, he's just been really stressed out, and he's just not in a good mental spot, so... It's one of those things that, like, I think he bounces back on C moves, and I think he, you know, does really well for himself, but I know what's going on, and it perfectly explains why he's not, like, performing. He forfeited losers, so he didn't actually lose in losers.
Right. So, last thing for me, because it's 12:30 on the East Coast.
Yeah.
My boy, where does Duck end up at Evo? For the next five tournaments, do you take Duck or do you take who's around there? Do you take Duck or do you take Drug Fox?
I'm taking Duck. And Drug Fox has, like, had, like, multiple 25th place finishes, and aside from, I think, yeah, like, CEO is a good performance for him, but, like, unless it's Drug Fox's chic, like, I'm not very confident in Drug Fox at this point.
Mm.
And that's where, like, I'm really nervous about picking Drug Fox. I know Drug Fox has, like, elite tier potential, but, like, can't we also say that about Duck, who's, you know, beaten West Bulls the last two times, who's beaten Leffen two times now. And Duck has also gone close with people like, you know, Axe.
He's one of the few players that has taken a game from all six gods, actually, or five gods plus Leffen. He's taken games from every single one. Which is, I mean, games aren't sets, but still impressive. Like, I think so. I was still very young in the scene, but I saw Duck go game five against Mewtwo King Sheik, and for me, that was the most impressive thing I have seen Duck do. To beat Mewtwo King Sheik on FD as Samus. I was like, are you serious? Like, I think Duck is amazing, and I think he's put in a lot of work. And in my mind, he is the best unsponsored player right now.
I agree. And so, yeah, I'm easily going with Duck. I mean, I think the issue with Duck, right, is that he has these random matchups that he just gets destroyed in.
Yeah, like Falcon.
Falcon and, like, Ganon.
So basically, like, the Falcon family, right? He loses Falcon, and Ganon's not great for him. And, I mean, so we have two. There's TM and Juggle Guy for Ganon and Falcon practice in Michigan, but he spends all of his time playing against Fox and Puff. And it kind of showed where actually at Smash and Splash, Wizzy and Nun both beat KJH and Duck. They both lost to the same people, which is ridiculous. And I wonder how often you ever see that, but it just shows that Michigan could use a bit of work against Falcon. And yeah, I think Ganon, but otherwise I think Duck. And also Ice Climbers. I've never seen Duck get beaten as badly as I saw him lose to Diz at Fight Pit, where Diz Kid JV 4 stocked him game one and 3-0'd him. And I was like, what? Jesus. So I think Duck has a little bit of work, like you said, like rounding the edges that he could do. But I agree. I think until we see Drug Fox, just stick with Sheik, in my opinion, as well. I would pick Duck for the next five tournaments too.
Yeah. And then anything else you want to kind of, it's like midnight for you.
Yeah, it's late. Just thanks so much for having me, for the chat. Thank you guys for tuning in. You can follow me on Twitter and Twitch at Fendrick Lamar. So this has been a super blast, and I'm looking forward to the Commentator's Curse. When are you doing that? Wednesday, right?
Thursday. Last week was because it was Wednesday last time because of CEO.
Yeah. Yeah, so hopefully I don't know if I will be at Xanadu this week, but hopefully I'll start going back soon to get some tune-ins for Evo. Did you send in a reel for Evo?
No. I want to relax because I'm going to be hanging out with people. And
nice.
My girlfriend's coming, so I didn't want to have my time, like my limited time, be taken up. And I'm both probably going to have to do pools. So.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay. Hopefully I'll hear back from them soon. I'd love to do some commentary at Evo. Oh, Blur says he might have to do Wednesday because he might be flying to What the Fox. So maybe we'll be on Wednesday.
Okay, fair enough. I think most of the time we probably have to do like Wednesday in the next like month and a half, just given how many tournaments there are.
Yeah. Another thing you guys can do, I don't know if there's anyone in the chat that would even be filling out an application, but application for SmashCon commentary. I think there's like a couple weeks left on that. And then hopefully be putting together a little bit of some there. You guys register for SmashCon, register for Shine. Big House registration opens this Friday. I'm pretty sure Rob said it's coming down the pipeline.
Is there any benefits for going early or registering early? Do I get a free T-shirt?
Another like early T-shirt stuff. You get T-shirts. Which worked for Genesis, right? They got like 600 registrants in the first 2 days. I think that was... Really quickly, sidebar, I think that was a mistake by Juggle Guy waiting that long and that Genesis opened registration before Big House. I think Big House will be fine, but he should have opened registration sooner so people could have at least gotten some registration in. You know, I don't know how some people are tight on money. Or not, I don't know how, but like some people might be. They had to choose one or the other, and because Genesis already opened up, and Genesis is, there's no way around the book. Like, Genesis is expensive, right? $50 early reg plus $20 minimum for seating on Sunday. So you're looking at least $70 for tournament. That's not a, that's also not entering anything. That's not counting flights. That's not counting hotels. So it's, you know, it's a lot. So I think Juggle Guy maybe should have rolled that one out a little sooner. But I still encourage everybody to go. It's going to be amazing. It's at the same venue, but it's going to be even bigger. And you guys already know it's the best run tournament series, period, in my opinion. So come on out to those tournaments. It's going to be a great summer for Smash, as Tafo and I both have alluded to. There's a lot of great tournaments. So watch his stuff. Watch What the Fox this weekend. And yeah, like I said, at Fendrick Lamar for Twitter and for Twitch as well. Stream pretty infrequently, but sometimes. Once again, Tafo, thank you to you for letting me join your Tafo Talk. And great stuff again this weekend. I was really impressed. I thought you and Toph killed it. And I hope to see you on the mic more in the coming future. And we'll be at a lot of events together. So hopefully maybe we'll even get to do a block together. That'd be fun.
That'd be awesome. Well, thanks for coming in, volunteering. And it was always a pleasure. So yeah, have a great night.
Yeah. All right, guys. Thanks again. Twitch chat, much love. Prince Abu, still much love if he's still here. All right, Tafo, have a great rest of your night, man. Thanks again.
All right, you too.